Hello and welcome to this Wealth Track interview on Medicare. I'm Consuela Mack. If you are on Medicare or not, someday you will be, and a loved one most likely is enrolled in the program now. I know from personal experience with my parents, it is a maze with several parts. They all seem to be moving and changing, which is why I have asked Katy Votava, president and founder of GoodCare.com, a Medicare consulting firm, to join us. Katy is a registered nurse with a PhD in health economics and nursing. She is also the author of a new eBook, Making the Most of Medicare, a Guide for Baby Boomers. She is also a columnist for InvestmentNews, and she is an acknowledged expert on Medicare. So, Katy Votava, thank you so much for joining us on Wealth Track for what I know will be the first of many discussions I'm going to have with you, because many of our viewers and our listeners have asked me to help them, to guide them through Medicare, and that's why I've come to you. So thank you for being with us.
Thank you, Consuelo, for inviting me to be part of the Wealth Track conversation, because as you know, and everyone's experiencing, whether they're in Medicare or, as you mentioned, family members, it's just a part of what we're dealing with in healthcare today. So I'm happy to help and give people some basic background so that they have some information and tools that they can move forward in a way that makes sense for them.
Great. And, you know, one of the things that I did not realize, and that I, when I looked at your book, is that I found out is that 95% of people pay too much for Medicare. How is that possible? Why is that happening?
Right. You know, that is a startling statistic, Consuelo. And that statistic comes out of good research from college universities around the United States. And why it happens is that people are not familiar with how to shop for Medicare. You actually have many choices in Medicare, and you have to base them on your own health status. And you have to shop in a smart way. We call it shop smart for Medicare, so that you can make fit a plan that's going to work for your needs. And most people don't understand that, the choices they have. And then when they go to make choices, they start to realize there are so many, it's easy to get overwhelmed. But there are ways to simplify the shopping process so that you can get a plan that's going to cover your needs and then minimize extra out-of-pocket costs, because that's what's happening. People are getting a plan and predominantly looking at a premium cost as opposed to what services they need and medications they take. But if you match those two up better, then you're not experiencing surprises when you go to the pharmacy to pick up a medication, or you go see a doctor and there's a big copay you did not expect. So you have to look ahead of time and make those choices for your individual needs.
Okay. So this interview is going to be a primer. And so assume I know nothing about Medicare. I know that you see individual clients and that you do it on a fee, on a, you know, a fee basis. So assume that, I'm a new client, I've come in, and I'm about to be eligible for Medicare. What do I need to know?
Okay, we see people like that all the time here at Good Care, and we work with people all over the country. And how we start the Good Care is to have a conversation about, first of all, timing. When are you turning 65? That's the first time you're eligible for Medicare. Some people will pick up some or all parts of Medicare, and we'll talk about the parts in a moment. Some will not pick up perhaps any, depending on other insurance options. So we want to sort through that decision tree of when do you need to enter Medicare and what parts do you enter, because there's timing issues and cost issues. If you delay entry into Medicare when you're not allowed to, you'll pay a penalty down the road that you'll pay for the rest of your life. That's easy to avoid if you have that conversation. So that's what we do, is we talk about, do you have any other insurance options? Are you employed? Do you have a spouse who's employed? Even if you have employer coverage, is it working for you? Or sometimes you're required to go into Medicare. So we sort those issues out.
Okay. Let me stop you there for 1 second, because if you are becoming eligible for Medicare and you are covered, for instance, by either your own insurance plan or a spouse or a significant other, should you not apply for Medicare?
Here's my advice. First of all, there are real rules about this. But if you work for an employer group, or your spouse or significant other works for an employer group that is 20 or more people, you are not required to apply for Medicare. If you are if your coverage comes through an employer group that is 19 or fewer, technically you're not required to apply, but you're not going to have the coverage you think that you're going to have, because you need to have Medicare Parts A and B. Part A is hospital, Part B is outpatient. And if you don't have that Part B portion for all things outpatient, you're actually only going to have 20% coverage for your cost. And then not be able to pick up that Part B coverage when you want to, because there are limited time windows, a window of opportunity to get in when you're 65, and then only once a year can you get into that coverage. So it's based on how large the employer is. Also, not everyone's coverage that they currently have works well for them. If they're paying a lot for medications that perhaps aren't covered, or they're seeing doctors and hospitals and care providers that are what I would call out-of-network coverages, have any more in-network, you pay less. Out-of-network, you pay more. So even if you don't have to move to full Medicare coverage, it might be better coverage for you where you have more options and save money.
Okay, very interesting. I mean, already I can see why we need a consultant for this. It's much more complicated than mm-hmm. many of us had assumed. So those are the questions: when are you eligible, and what your current mm-hmm. situation is. So tell me, go forward with this conversation. Let me
sure.
What are the next questions or the information that you want to know from me?
Well, then I want you to be familiar with the fact that Medicare has three separate parts and multiple ways to put it together depending on what your health needs are. The three parts I mentioned, two already: Medicare Part A for hospital care. That's the portion that we all get once we've paid into Social Security over time and we don't pay a fee for it, whether we have worked enough or ourselves. Part B for outpatient benefit covers all things outpatient: seeing a doctor, getting a laboratory test, having chemotherapy, outpatient surgery, so on and so forth. There is a premium for Part B that's based on your income, and it's a sliding scale. And we can provide that for your listeners. But the basic cut point is $170,000 for a couple filing jointly, or $85,000 for an individual. And if they make more than that, they'll pay more than the base rate, which this year is $105 a month. But you need to get those first two parts of Medicare, A and B. And then the third part is called Medicare D for drug coverage. It's prescription drug coverage. And beyond that, there are two major ways to put those parts together. There's something called Medicare Part C, which is really not a separate part of Medicare. It's a way to roll it all into one coverage. It's very similar to HMO coverage, health maintenance organization coverage, or employer PPO coverage. A lot of people are used to that language. And you would have that coverage with a private insurer. The upside of those plans are that they're often can be more economical, not necessarily depending on your health, but they all have networks. Sometimes they work great, sometimes not so great for a person's health. The other way is to have your Medicare A, B, and a drug plan, and then get a separate thing that many people call a supplemental, and technically it's called a Medigap plan. So you can already see that there's a maze of choices here. And then my next step is not to mire in those choices, but to ask you about your health, because that's where the rubber hits the road. That's what determines where you're going to go and how you're going to save your money. And the two main things, it's what's your list of medications you take, because plans are not required to cover the same medications for the same cost. In any area where you live, there will be perhaps 20 or 30 plans.
Wow.
They all charge a very different price for your medication. And when we said earlier that 95% of people are overspending, very often it's on prescription drug coverage. And then I want to know a list of, what are your care providers? What doctors do you see? What hospitals do you want to go to? Your physical therapist, counselors, social workers, those types of people, because will they be what I would call in the network, or will they be out of network? If they're out of network, you probably want to have a certain type of coverage, a Medigap plan. And so it really stems from some simple information about your health, Consuelo, and the medications you take and where you want to go for your health care. So that's really what I talk about first, getting a better handle on that. And then after we talk about that, I will be able to give advice to say, okay, you're going to pursue this major way to go. Maybe Medicare Advantage plans are going to work for you. Or, given your health and your needs, you're going to go the route of Medicare A, B, and a drug plan and still pick the right drug plan and either assist as your personal shopper, so to speak, or we do coach people too. We have webinars on occasion where people we can teach people to do what we do. For example, people can go to Medicare.gov and start some of their shopping themselves. Some people like to do that. It still, for many people, can be overwhelming, particularly the first time you do it. But those are the big things that we talk about at first, is timing, the two main ways to put coverage together, and then really get into some basic questions about how you prefer your health, where you prefer to get your services, and what your medications are.
What a fascinating conversation. And it definitely is not one plan fits all. So when we talk about this gigantic, Medicare coverage, there are so many moving parts to this. And I'm assuming it changes state by state, right? That the kind of insurance coverage that you can get is going to be different depending on where you live. Is that correct?
You're quite right, Consuelo. It does vary by where you live, but it varies even more finely than you might think. It varies down to the county and zip code level.
Really?
Yes.
Why is that?
It's the way the rules are constructed and the way insurance is issued, because the drug plans, Medicare D plans, they are regulated by the government. They're all private insurance plans, and then they're regulated by the state. And the same with these Medicare Advantage plans are regulated by the government and the state through the insurance department. And they do their underwriting and applications down to that fine of a level. Medigap itself is somewhat state level, but more and more we're seeing it vary even more around within states than we used to. So it adds to the complication, because people will say, well, my friend has this plan. Well, maybe, first of all, your friend's health is different than yours. That's A, number one. But number two is, if they live across the street with the county and zip code in the other direction, you might not have that plan, or perhaps you do, but it's a different price, has some different features to that plan.
And will Medicare.gov, is it sophisticated enough to be able to guide you on your individual situation, or I know you can go to a Social Security office, for instance. Is there a Medicare office that you can go to as well to discuss these with individual counselors that the government provides, or what are our options aside from going to someone like you, which is what I'm feeling that I definitely, when I am eligible, should do, no question that I should be doing. What are the options for everyone else?
I think here are, I think, a couple good options for people, because Medicare.gov is fine, but it's typically overwhelming for people at first. I think you have to have a little more familiarity with Medicare. So there are two places people can go. One is, actually, you can call Medicare, 1-800-MEDICARE, 24 hours a day, and they will help you locate plans and go through many options. And you talk to an individual. I find that they're more versed on Medicare drug plans and Medicare Advantage plans, not as much on the Medigap. But it is a free service and it's available.
Okay.
The other place you can go is, in every county in the United States, we have something called an Area Office on Aging. They all have different names, but they provide this service that's required on a nationwide basis. Our tax pay for it. You can go to a website called eldercare.gov, put in your zip code, and find out who gives the Medicare advice in your area, and they'll do it in one of two ways. They often have public meetings available around that fall annual enrollment time. Even if you're not in Medicare, you may have seen all the ads that are on television and everything. Every fall, October 15th through December 7th, everyone who's in Medicare can reevaluate their plan. Great idea. And many of these offices will have informational meetings in local community centers. You want to sign up for them early because their slots will fill up. The other thing they do is individual advising. Again, contact them early because it takes them a few days to get back to you. There are only so many people that work with them. Some are volunteers, but their capacity is limited. So don't wait till you're desperate for information, because then you may not be able to, most likely won't get in. But those are two good resources, are Medicare themselves and the national network through that you can find through eldercare.gov.
Great. And let me ask you a final question, because as I said, Katy, we will definitely continue this conversation on WealthTrack, on a podcast and also on the program on public television in the very near future. And the question is, my understanding is that you really should review your Medicare plan every year. That's what you advise. Is that correct? And why is that?
Everyone, you're right, Consuelo, should look at their plan every year. You have that window of opportunity in the fall. And I particularly recommend that people do it if their health care costs have increased, if they're on medications that are not well covered, if they have found out that a care provider is no longer in network. And even if everything sounds great, you still need to look at your plan to see if it's as good as it was last year. Because the insurance companies will send the premium information to you. Here's your new premium, usually goes up a little.
Yes.
And deductible information, but they don't give you a list to say, here's where your medications were last year, and this is what they're going to cost you next. And so you just have to pick up the phone and call them. Even if things are going right, just verify that they're going to continue to go right the next year. And if you've had some things that concern you, you really should shop and could do better perhaps the next year.
All right. Terrific. We're going to leave this conversation here, and I will be talking to you in the near future.
All right.
So, Katy Votava, president and founder of GoodCare.com. I mentioned you're the author of a new ebook, Making the Most of Medicare, a Guide for Baby Boomers, and you're also a columnist for Investment News. I thank you so much for joining us. This is a fascinating topic. It's an essential one, and I know that our audience will be very pleased that I've had you on, and we'll be talking to you again. Thanks so much for joining us, Katy.
Thank you so much.